Hi everyone, my name is Camille Ryder. I'm a senior in James River High School Specialty Center for Leadership and International Relations. I just wanted to take a second before the video gets started to thank you all for receiving the content that I've been posting so well. I've already gotten a few messages from people and that just means the world to me. So I hope you continue to be inspired and want to learn, and please share this with your friends or share it with anyone, because I have created this so that anyone who wants to learn about music can learn. Thank you. Enjoy the video. Hi, Mr. Rollins. It's really good to see you.
Great to see you, Camille.
Yeah, so could you give me a little background about your history with music and how you got into it?
Sure. Growing up, I really have to say my mother was the biggest influence on my musical career. And that's because my mother is a lifelong musician. She's actually 88 right now, and she still plays piano virtually every day. But she grew up in Texas and started playing piano lessons when she was about 7 years old. That's what she went to school for, both her bachelor's and master's degrees. And then she came to North Carolina to teach music at an upstart university then called Wingate College, which is now Wingate University. But, you know, the long story short is that growing up, we always had music playing in our house. Most of it was classical music and gospel, or what you'd call Southern gospel. My mother was very much being a church musician for over 50 years. We always had recordings of gospel going in the house, classical music like Beethoven and Mozart, some jazz, or really, and I'll talk more about jazz, obviously, in a minute. But growing up, jazz wasn't a huge thing played in her house, but still, she had a soft spot for people more traditional, like Louis Armstrong, Tommy Dorsey, Benny Goodman, people like that. Not so much the folks that later I would gravitate to.
Awesome. So, obviously, you're here to talk about jazz. So how is jazz different from any other music genre?
Someone in the early 1920s asked Louis a question, and they intended it to be kind of a trap question or a trick question, a gotcha question, say, how many different kinds of music are there? And Louis responded, he says, well, I know of two. There's the good and the other stuff. Good music conveys the emotions, not only the music, but it also conveys the emotions of the performer. However, the thing I think that makes jazz distinct is that it intentionally seeks to maximize that unique quality of the performer more so than any other music. For example, if a violinist is playing a Beethoven violin concerto, they certainly may have different interpretations of phrasing and even tempo, given their relationship with the conductor of the piece. But largely, if they're playing Beethoven's violin concerto in E, it's gonna be largely the same from night to night to night to night. There may be some variances in tempo and phrasing from night to night, but largely it's gonna be the same rhythms and notes from performance to performance, because to do otherwise would not be faithful to Beethoven's conception. Jazz, by its very nature, is so open-ended, it's purposely designed that a large part of the performance is supposed to be the performer's, rather the improviser's, take on that section of the tune. And so every night, for example, a tune like Autumn Leaves, which is a simple little jazz standard, but in the hands of a master, every night that performance will be different, and some nights would be so radically different that a listener probably would not be able to necessarily associate it with a prior performance. Jazz is ever-changing in real time. In other words, the nature of the performance is subject to the context of the moment. I have a good friend who's in theater, and we talk about the magic of the moment. And everyone who's gone to a live show, regardless if it's a concert or a play, they feel it. Heck, even if you go see a good speaker or a good sermon at church, you feel the magic of the moment. It's the immediacy of being there. Well, to me, jazz capitalizes on the magic of the moment, because you're feeling the magic of the moment of what that performer is feeling right then and there. They're not just playing through the notes and the rhythms that someone else preconceived. They're playing their ideas, their feelings. And so that's part of what I love about jazz, is its spontaneity, which is so critical to its core of what it is.
Yeah, that's awesome. So a follow-up question, Why is it important to keep jazz alive and have people continue learning about it?
Kind of have two takes on this. The first is this. It is, unfortunately, a lot of, I don't want to sound like a member of the older generation, like a crotchety old man, but I am. So here goes. I'll just admit to that. Jazz is an American art form. And I use the word art form intentionally because it's music of the highest caliber. And as a matter of fact, if someone, for example, and I don't mean this to be polishing my own apple or blowing my own horn, use whatever pun you wish. But I've been a participant in music for over 50 years. As someone who's invested that much of my life in it, I've encountered a great many forms of music. And I can tell you, in my opinion, and yes, it is just my opinion, but I will tell you it's shared by many of the musicians I associate with, I know of no other musical form that requires more of the performer and the composer than jazz does. It is, so it's an incredibly in-depth exploration of this wonderful discipline we call music. And the so it is an American art form, whereas Americans, we're very proud, for example, in school, we talk about movements and markers of our great American experiment. We, you know, we talk about the Declaration of Independence. We talk about the westward expansion. We talk about the Civil War. You know, we talk about all these epic moments, the, you know, the Transcontinental Railroad, et cetera, et cetera. We make sure we talk about these moments in our history to convey the where our country's come from. Well, jazz is every bit as important and as revealing as any of those. And just as it's important that we know about our country's lineage, we jazz is a part of that lineage. And I will say, particularly in today's climate of, fortunately, our society is becoming more and more inclusive. And we're starting to recognize that historically, there are some things we need to reevaluate. We need to look at through a different lens to be more empathetic. Jazz has always been that style of music. It has been a very inclusive music from the very beginning. Jazz itself was formed by, if you will, a melting pot of different cultures. It basically came out of, the roots of jazz came from Africa and the slave trade through New Orleans. And what I want to say is its improvisational and rhythmic ideas came largely from Africa. That explains part of the incredible complexity of it. And then the harmonic and melodic ideas, some of them came from classical music in Europe. And those two ideas were fused to produce a unique music that did not exist elsewhere in the world at that time. So as an American who's proud of being an American, to me, it's inconceivable that we don't, as Americans, understand this is an incredibly great thing to be proud of. Which leads me to point number two. In the world today, jazz is beloved in virtually every country it's been introduced in. As a matter of fact, if you go to Japan, jazz is just fanatically followed. Germany, Zimbabwe, Russia, it is a cultural phenomenon in all those countries. And yet in the United States, jazz is really kind of a fringe music. I mean, yes, the aficionados know of it, but I would say your typical listener here doesn't know about as much about jazz as they do, for example, and this is not to eschew other forms, but they don't know as near much about jazz as they do country or hip hop or rock or even classical music. They're not as familiar with it. And a lot of it is simply because they don't frame themselves to be receptive to it. It's not because the music is incredibly difficult to comprehend. As a matter of fact, I would tell you, I believe jazz, it hits your soul immediately. And once it's got you, it's got you. But so I believe it's jazz is an inclusive music. It reveals the best of who we are, and it also reveals the best of others that we've associated with. To this day, jazz is very rich with cultural contributions from other areas, such as the myriad forms of Latin jazz we have that show the Afro-Cuban influence of the Caribbean, and the Latin American styles that proliferate through South America, such as samba and bossa nova. And even today, we're getting Asian elements in jazz. We get Eastern European elements like klezmer in jazz. It's just, it's a very inclusive music. And because of that, it's ever evolving. And we can be proud that it started here, and it's still worldwide. We're seen as the, I mean, if you talk about, you go to Tokyo, they'll talk about New York's the mecca of jazz, and it really is. But we unfortunately don't recognize that here.
Since jazz is always changing and always evolving and including new cultures, how do you recommend people who aren't familiar with it to start listening and start absorbing it? Because it is kind of like classical music in that at first it can be very intimidating. And without the consistency that, you know, pop music has, it's harder to get involved, you know?
I think the first thing I would recommend, if possible, is to go to a live performance. That the reason I say that, to me, the essence of music is best conveyed through experiencing it in that magic moment of the here and now. So go to a community concert. There are a ton of jazz ensembles, community bands around that play jazz. There are venues in town. Just Google live jazz and go out and hear and experience the music. You want to experience the music. Experience the music first, and you'll start, as you listen to it, you'll start to gain aspects of it that will speak more or resonate more with you than others. And then you can be curious and say, one of the things about jazz musicians is they're incredibly giving, and during the breaks, they would love it if you came up and talked to them about the music. They're not going to be standoffish and tell you they're not going to have security like rock folks and say, get away from the stage. You can go up and talk to them. One of the things that anyone getting to jazz is going to find is that it's every bit, the term jazz is a huge umbrella that covers every bit as much as saying the word rock or pop does. Jazz is equally diverse. You know, are you talking about rhythm and blues? Are you talking about field song? Are you talking about Dixieland, big band, et cetera, cool jazz? Find out about something and then start going with it. Just be curious, and it won't take you long to start forming your own taste. And then that will tend to lead you in other paths, and you'll naturally fill out your playlist then. And again, there's tons of algorithms now on Spotify and iTunes and CD Baby that if you start compiling playlists, then the algorithms and the machines are going to start to feed you other artists to listen to. And they're based on mostly, there's some marketing there for sure, but it's valid. I mean, if you like Miles Davis, there's a pretty good chance that you're going to like Jerry Mulligan, et cetera, et cetera, and John Coltrane and Herbie Hancock, things like that. So it doesn't take you long to get immersed in jazz and to become knowledgeable about it. And no, you don't have to be a music nerd. That's the thing. You don't have to know, you don't have to know a ton of music theory. You don't have to know any music theory. All you have to do is have a pair of ears and listen. And as it's kind of like walking to a theater and listening to a film score. If it's great music, it speaks to you right away. You don't have to know how the composer did the musical details to get that effect. You just have to appreciate it and say, wow, that's really great music. It's very stirring, or that music's very haunting, or it's very melancholy. Jazz it doesn't ask any more than that.
The inclusivity part reminded me of a story I think you told. I think it was Charlie Parker or Miles Davis, and you said that they changed their music to crazy key signatures and time signatures so no one would copy them.
Yeah, and the part of that was kind of a revolutionary reaction. It's basically there's a very famous producer. He's a mega producer named Quincy Jones, who actually was the producer for Michael Jackson's Thriller album, and he's been a colossus in the industry for 50 years. Well, he likens the beboppers to the hip hop artists when they first came out. And that is, if you remember, if you go back to the roots of hip hop, when it first came out, it was very, even more so than today, it was very controversial music. Not just because of the lyrics, but because of the instrument combinations that were used and the sound production qualities. They intentionally did things that in prior styles of music would have been considered, quite frankly, wrong. But they intentionally did it. Well, the beboppers did the same thing. They, in a sense, wanted to be reactionist against the prevailing jazz of the time, which was big band swing. And so they purposely designed their music to be the kind of the anti-big band. And they, for example, big band's primary function really was to be dance music. And so the boppers decided we don't want to be considered dance music. We want the music to be intellectual. So we want people listening to our music, not dancing to it. So how did they get around that? Well, they formed the tempos either incredibly too fast to dance to or incredibly too slow to dance to. And then the juxtaposed double time choruses in the middle of a slow ballad, so you couldn't be dancing with your honey because all of a sudden it'd break into 250 beats a minute. And then versus the accessible chord changes, a lot of blues based for big band, the boppers put in these extensions, 9s, 11s, and 13s with alterations in them. So yeah, musically we call that dissonance. So that the a lot of the sounds were intentionally meant to be trying or challenging for people to digest. And much like what the hip hoppers did, or frankly, any revolution in music, if you look at it, it's got those aspects in it. You look at Scherberg with 12-tone music. If you look at the early days of rock and roll with distortion and guitar, I mean, people, they debated whether or not that was music. They were like, that's noise.
Yeah, I'm going to ask another follow-up, but you said, so what do you think defines music? Because you mentioned some people said, oh, that's just noise.
Wow, you know what? I will say this totally would have caught me off guard. Except a student asked this of me probably 20 years ago. To me, the hallmark of music is this, and I want to say with emphasis on a certain word here, it is organized sound and silence. Organized, that's the key word there. A lawnmower is not, to me, is not music. However, it can be made into music if, for example, it's sampled and stored in a computer and then sliced up and given a rhythm and pitch variances. Sure, a dog squeezing right now, like you're my 16 and a half year old pug, that's not music. But yet again, if I were to squeeze him in a rhythmic fashion, you could argue that I was making music out of it. So to me, all art, to me, regardless if you're talking about painting or ceramics or dance or poetry, it bears the mark of what I call human craftsmanship. And to me, that's the difference between noise is not so much a quality of sound, it's a quality about the it's about the intent of the sound. In other words, does the intent, does the construct show there was intention and particularly intelligent intention behind it?
I like the addition of silence. I think that's really important in music, and we don't always acknowledge it, is the pauses and the ends and the beginnings, not just the middle.
Two words for you on that. Just two words for that, for anyone talking about silence. Miles Davis. End of story.
Gotta love Miles Davis. Okay, so my next question is for you as a teacher. In your experience, you've had a lot of success, and I've experienced it firsthand with getting students to be passionate about jazz and be successful in playing it. How do you inspire kids to do it and get them excited about jazz?
The music sells itself. There's something in jazz that resonates with human beings, and it doesn't matter if you're 15 or if you're 95 or anywhere in between, or heck, even on the other sides of that spectrum. Jazz has a unique ability. As Louis says, again, I'm going to steal, Louis says it's the music of life. He says what we play is life, and I absolutely agree. I believe that's really true of all music, but I think especially of jazz, it has a dynamism to it that hits. If you're a player or a singer with enough skill to encounter jazz, and the thing is, jazz has such a spectrum that really you don't have to have phenomenal abilities to play certain types of jazz. You can immediately, with just a little bit of proficiency, you can enter into the world of jazz and experience it. And it will grab you right away. Again, I'll just say that I would love to take credit for saying that it's something that I would like to look good and say, wow, it was Rollins' magic crystal ball that I've figured out some way to sell jazz. But it's really not. It's the music itself. From that first year, I've not worried about it. I just, the bottom line is, if you get a student involved in jazz, you get a player or singer involved in jazz, they're gonna like it. They're gonna love it.
Yeah, I think that goes for any group where the piece is written with like intent and passion. There is always that feeling, you know. But the thing that I think is really awesome about jazz is that there are no rules. Like with classical music, it is beautiful, but you're following structure, you're trying to hit, you know, the four movements, And of course, there are always rule breakers, but jazz is just a blank canvas. So I was wondering if you could speak a little bit to that and speak about the intricacies of jazz. And I know this is a lecture that's a bit more for anyone. So,
yeah.
But yeah, a general overview of that technicality of it.
The basics, I thought about this because when I looked at this, I said, wow, this is a loaded question, because the basics, I think I have three things that I feel fairly comfortable with. With regard to the intricacies, frankly, we would have to have this interview go on for another 3 years to really probably deal with that. But I think I've got a summation that maybe works for that as well. To me, the three, and again, this is debatable. My opinion by no means is the last word on this. But when I really considered it, I think there are three core aspects of any idea of jazz. And the first is that jazz at its heart involves spontaneous creation by the performers, improvisation, which we'll talk about more in a minute because I know you have a question about that specifically. So any form of jazz, regardless if it's Dixieland or early blues or big band or bop or cool or anything, all of those styles feature that at some point the performers will spontaneously create melodies that are within the context of that style and follow the harmonic progressions that the composer has created, or that the group themselves spontaneously come up and basically tell the composer, we don't want to use your chord progressions, we're going to come up with something right here on the spot. So the first element is improvisation. The second element relates to what I just talked to, where the performers, they create a group dynamic, a rapport, if you will, where, and I need to clarify here, because again, I feel like this exists in all really well-functioning musical groups. For example, a group that comes to mind right away is the rock group Rush, a very tremendously talented group where there's an interplay between Geddy Lee and Alex Lifeson and Neil Peart. You know, the triangle of them, they were always reacting to what each other did, but still it's within a more defined framework. For example, if they were going to play the song Tom Sawyer, the song wasn't going to suddenly take off and sound like it was in a different time signature, or it wasn't going to sound like one of their other tunes. Unlike in jazz, the group rapport between the drummer, the bass player, the horn player, the keyboard player, et cetera, it is subject to the whims and the immediacy of what the performers are doing. So for example, you always have to be on your toes if you're in a jazz group, and particularly if you're in a small jazz group, like say a typical combo. So if you're a drummer, you can't just go into autopilot and play a pattern. You have to listen to what the soloist does and respond to that. By that, you're really engaging in a musical conversation. The ultimate goal is to enrich the experience, not only for performers, but for the listeners themselves and the audience. And so really they can appreciate that immediate group rapport or communication that exists between the players. So the first was improvisation. The second is the group rapport. And the third is what I'll just call swing. Because not all jazz is swing, but I do believe that all jazz has unique feel. And, you know, again, there's a great number of jazz pieces that are defined as being some kind of swing style. And swing is basically a rhythmic and phrasing approach to how you play things. So it has a feel to it. And it frankly is a dance-based feel. It should have a groove to it, you know, and yeah, all good music has a groove to it. You certainly can listen to hip hop or listen to funk or listen to reggae, and there are grooves that define that. Well, in a similar way, swing is jazz. And there's a lot of pop and other forms that have been very influenced by jazz swing. To me, to talk about the core basics of jazz, you've got improvisation, you've got the group rapport between the musicians communicating and responding to each other, and then finally, everything has a distinctive feel, a swing, if you will. Now, with regard to the intricacies, I'll make this one quick. The intricacies come in how those three things are employed, and that's where the lifetime of talking comes about, the lifetime of talking and exploring and listening, because quite frankly, there's so much nuance involved in that. And the masters, they would tell you, as Dizzy Gillespie, I actually didn't realize I was going to quote him, but I just remembered a great quote he had. Dizzy said, the more I know, the more I don't know, which again, I think answers a lot about your question to me about intricacies. I'm still figuring out intricacies, and I will be if you come back in 20 years. Now, there's some of the stuff that by intentionality, it's not meant, again, like the boppers or the stuff that's in 7-4. It's not meant to make you want to dance necessarily, but most jazz does have kind of propulsion to it that makes you want to move. And so there it is.
Yeah, and I think a lot of Western music is still very on the beat, and it's very inspired by that. And when we hear, and jazz is more about dissonance, and that could be rhythmic or tonal. Yeah. So I kind of asked this question already, but it's our final question. How do we encourage students who don't necessarily have a background in music to become involved in the music community, especially in jazz?
Great question. And this is one, again, I prepared myself for this one because I feel very passionate about this. Pop culture, in general society, doesn't want us sometimes, and I don't understand why. We have this built-in view that music's only for the elite talented. In other words, if you start piano and after a year you don't sound like you're the next coming of Mozart, probably means that music's not for you. You shouldn't keep, you know, there are other things you can use your time better on than music. A kid playing with tinker toys, we don't ask them if they're going to build something that can support 40 tons. We just let them build and have fun. Well, I think too often we put up this roadblock to young musicians and even not so young musicians. For example, I can't tell you how many times I've heard people make the statement to me who are my age or even older than me come up and say, you know what, I played piano years ago and I gave it up, and I just look at them and smile and I'm like, and? Because I know, I'm thinking, you know, and I smile, make sure they know that I'm not trying to play with them too much, but I'm like, and would you like to start it up again? And their reaction is always shock, is like they're aghast, like, oh my gosh, I could never do that. I'm not talented. And it just makes me want to grab a 10,000 watt bullhorn and yell in their ear, it's not about talent, because it's not. Music is not meant to be an elitist activity. One of the benefits I've had of teaching the classes I teach in my school is that in one of my classes, we look at not only American and Western centric musics like American music, but we look at musics from all around the world. And most of the world has the right idea, in my opinion, about music. And that is, they view music as something that you do because you're a human being. In other words, in Africa, if you don't make music, that would be as amusing to them as if you didn't breathe. Now, I shouldn't say not breathing is not the music, but in other words, they would view making music as natural as breathing and as walking. In other words, it's something you do. It's a means of communication. It's a way you artistically express. They don't worry about how good it sounds. They just take the joy out of it. It's a means of communal communication. And so that's where I think I would encourage anyone, regardless, number one, if you want to get involved with music as a performer, as a singer or a player, don't let shows like America's Got Talent or American Idol or The Voice scare you away from it and be like, oh my gosh, I saw a five-year-old on there who sings opera. I can't do that. You know what? The reason she's on the show is she's five. That's the reason she's on the show. It's not because it's a freakish thing. And yes, it's an amazing thing, but doesn't mean that you have to be like that to enjoy music. If you want to enjoy music, dive in, like swimming, dive in, enjoy it, you know, get you a good instructor, regardless if it's private or online or at your school, dive in and enjoy it. Make music with your friends. Just for right now, enjoy the act of making sound in an intentional way. And trust me, the nuances will come later. Just now, you have to work at it. Again, I will tell you there, and I'm not trying to be all doom and gloom here. I'm just saying, just like a sport, it's not about talent. It is about loving it and working your tail off. And if you do that, you know what? You're going to get pretty good. Now, the other thing I'll say this, there's some people who try music and for whatever reason, it's not for them. And that's okay. Just in the same way that some people try a certain sport and they're like, you know what? I tried it. I really gave it my best shot, but it truly just didn't resonate with me. That doesn't mean you still can't be involved in music. I would say it's a pretty strong possibility that if you were to interview 1,000 people and say, do you listen to music? You'd probably get 1,000 out of 1,000 would say yes. Okay, why is that?
well, there must be something intrinsic about music that we do. It's not, we don't do it just because it's hip or because it's socially fashionable to do it. There must be something in it for us. Well, I would again say, if you were to simplify it, well, what's in it for us? Enjoyment, okay? It's part of life's pleasure, okay? Just like eating a great meal, it's part of the pleasure of life. Well, let me give you a culinary metaphor to kind of equate. You don't have to be a musician, a player, a performer, or a singer to enjoy music. You simply have to be curious. Just like, for example, I think some people let the veneer of music scare them away. And I think actually this is probably more true in classical music than it is of jazz. And it's, to me, it's not the music. If you allow the music to reach you, you're a human being, the music will reach you. I promise you that. It's about the veneer. Like if you think of classical music and all you see are suits and long dresses and you know, opera glasses and stuffed personalities in a concert hall, that's a veneer. That doesn't mean that's what the music's about. If you see jazz and all you see is a really dimly smoke-lit room with people saying strange things and things going on, their shady underbellies of society, that again is a veneer. That's not what the music's about. Don't let that frighten you away. It doesn't mean you have to be of that, you don't have to be of that context to appreciate it. Just be who you are and listen. I will say this again, probably one of the greatest jazz musicians ever, he's considered to me the Beethoven of jazz, is Duke Ellington. And I'll finish with this because I can't think of anything in jazz that's better than finishing with a Duke Ellington quote. All the answers in the music. All the answers are in the music. All you have to do is listen. That's jazz.
I think that's an amazing way to wrap this up. And thank you so much for taking the time to talk to me.
Thank you.
Yeah, I really appreciate it. So
good luck with it.
Hey everyone, thank you so much for watching. I'm so glad that people are starting to interact with the material that I've been posting. Please continue to ask questions and send me opinions you have on anything or what you'd like to see next. I'd really love to hear from you. Thank you again for showing support. For more updates on my project, follow my Capstone on Instagram or check out my website. I'll include the links below in the video description. Have a great day and stay tuned.